so thanks for having me. So yeah, that's right, my first book of poetry is for children, but when I write for children, well, I like to think that I just write for everybody, the curious nature in everybody. So I'm going to be sharing some poems from this book, Daydreams and Jellybeans, my first book. There'll be a little bit of a collaboration in terms of kind of like, you know, maybe saying the poem back to me and filling in the gap. So I'm going to read a poem called Jellybean, right, for the first poem, and it goes like this. Listen carefully, because I'm going to be asking you to kind of read this one with me afterwards. Jellybean. There's a jelly bean stranded at the top of the stairs, and its blue beanie body is covered in hairs, and it's been there for days just gathering dust, and people walk by with a look of disgust. So I pick the bean up and I walk to the bin, but I change my mind before I throw it in. You see, the bin was full and I do hate to waste, and so I chewed the bean up. And what a wonderful taste. Thank you very much. So, there's going to be plenty of jelly beans actually in this little set. I'm going to ask you to read this one along with me now, if you're feeling ready. You feeling good for it?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go. So after me, when I point to you, you're going to, nice and loud as well. Let's finish well, okay? Jelly bean. There's a jelly bean stranded at the top of the stairs.
There's a jelly bean stranded at the stairs.
Its blue beanie body is covered in hairs.
Its blue beanie body is covered in hairs.
And it's been here for days just gathering dust.
And it's been here for days just gathering dust.
And people walk by with a look of disgust.
And people walk by with a look of disgust.
So I pick the bean up and I walk to the bin.
So I pick the bean up and I walk to the bin.
But I change my mind before I throw it in. You see, the bin was full and I do hate to waste.
You see, the bin was full and I do hate to waste.
And so I chewed the bean up and what a wonderful taste.
So I chewed the bean up and what a wonderful taste.
Applause for you. This will be the last time I read this poem, Jellybean, but there will be more Jellybean. So, this time I'm going to ask you to fill in the gaps. I'm going to read it pretty fast, so nice and loud with the gaps. Let's go. Here we go. There's a jellybean surrounded at the top of the
stairs.
Its blue beanie body is covered in
hair.
It's been there for days just gathering
dust.
And people walk by with a look of disgust.
Disgust.
So I pick the bean
up
and I walk to the
bin.
But I change my mind before I throw it
in.
You see, the bin was
full.
And I do hate to
waste.
So I chewed the bean
up.
And what a wonderful
taste.
Okay, so the next poem I'm going to read is another poem from this book. It's called Waterfall. You like to mix it up a little bit. I think when you're writing a collection of poetry, for those out there who wrote a collection of poetry or wrote an album, whatever it is, it's kind of heavy light. And even though there are lots of humorous poems in this book, they're kind of just slivers of who I am as a person. So I like nature. I spend a lot of time in nature. I like to give the kind of natural elements a story. And there are also kind of poems on social justice, on mental health, all these kind of things in this book. So I tried my best to make it kind of flavoured in such a way that you can, well, you know, like a good album would feel, I think. So it's a musical thing. It's a musical thing, poetry. This poem is called Waterfall, and it goes like this. You are all water, and all water is you. But this time you search for a pool to fall into. A journey into water is a journey home, wandering, folding, bursting and stretching like wet flames. Turn inside and over, roll into new water. And gather every sound, carry them off the edge of ground. Every stone smoothed and riverbed tickled. Each dip and twist of bird and fish, you fall again, together again. Whisper, burble, thunder, hiss. So this is a poem that I wrote. I was working on a project for CADU, CADU and Literature Wales combined. It was called CADU's Rich and Diverse History Development. I think it was that, yeah. CADU's Rich and Diverse History Development. And it was about, they asked me, they commissioned me to write poems and songs celebrating the lives of Black heritage people who have contributed to Wales, lived in Wales perhaps, or perhaps just had a special relationship with the people of Wales. So I don't know how many people in this room will know or have heard of Paul Robeson.
Yeah.
Okay. So what? Basically, they gave me an annex of 100 people, and I got to choose, you know, the people from that. And again, I wanted to, you know, I wanted to just give a story to some people that we'd never heard of. When I saw Paul Robeson, it was, you know, and I didn't. Someone had told me about Paul Robeson maybe a few years before, but it didn't just sink in. And when I did the research, I was just absolutely, you know, an absolutely sensational person. As a civil rights activist, an actor, a bass baritone singer, you know, theatre actor, movie star, just an all-round legend, really. And what, you know, the story has it that when he was living in London, he was performing at the theatre, and I think that he heard, when he was leaving the matinee, he heard songs, and it turned out to be the Welsh miners. They were on a, I think they might have been on a hunger strike, or they were on some sort of strike anyway. So he heard them, he joined them, and he sang with them, and then sang for them at the town hall. But the wonderful thing about this is Paul Robeson was coming from such a place of, you know, segregation, Jim Crow era. He was, you know, fighting a lot for the struggles of black people. But when he met the miners, he saw the plight in them, and he realised that the struggles were kind of, you know, international, really. And I just think that was such a lovely thing, that his relationship just went on till the day he died, you know, with these Welsh miners and with the people of Wales. So I wanted to write a poem to Paul Robeson, to celebrate Paul Robeson, to say thank you, basically. And it's called Diolch, Mr. Robeson. Diolch, Mr. Robeson, for borrowing your bass notes to those valley men that marched half empty, half hopeful that someone would hear them sing. You swept in, one river into another. Your voice, deep tone, deep as coal, is still remembered in the miners' old homes. The slim streets, smoke and slate, the mountains dark and bold, cold, thunder knows of you, rumbles of you. Diolch, Mr. Robeson, you knew of pain, son of escaped slave, son of God and the good words, man of law, right and wrong, man of sport and stage, man of song. Sing on, songs of freedom. Stir us in the chilling thrill of low sound underground. Carry us into light. A thousand heavy souls vibrating on your throat. Into sky. We are together. We are alive. And this life is brighter for everything you gave it. This life is brighter for everything you gave it. Thank you very much. So, I wrote a song for the black soldiers who were American black soldiers, Afro-American soldiers, as they were said. They came here during World War II and they came to fight. They were the only black battalion. They were called the 320th Barrage Balloon Battalion. A bit of a mouthful, that one is. But they, you know, again, what when I saw these on the annex, this is another song from the Cadbury's Rich and Diverse History Project. When I saw them, I thought, I couldn't believe my eyes, really. It was one of the last things to come up, and it just said something, something, something. And I saw Abasakan. I thought, Abasakan, what? What's the line about? That's where I live. That's on the other side of the Blorange. It's about 20 minutes from here. It's past Pontypool. So I thought, Abasakan, hang on a minute, what's going on? And when I looked at it, and all I saw were black soldiers, Abasakan, I thought, hang on, I was the only black person in that village, you know? So I thought, what is this? So anyway, I started looking at it, and it was just fascinating to know that these men were here during segregation, you know, during segregation again in America, to come here and fight, you know, in Europe, a war that they probably didn't know what was going on, you know, they were already oppressed in their own country. But the idea that they were integrated when they got here, so they had the ability to meet anybody, you know, fall in love with a white woman, just have fun, just go to pubs, whatever, just integrate generally. And I just thought it was absolutely amazing. So I wanted to write this song, which is basically like a letter home, I suppose, and it's from a soldier. I just imagined that perhaps he stood up, you know, I don't know, on the boat or in the church. Oh yeah, actually, I should say, they were billeted in a church called the Methodist Chapel on High Street, Abasakan, and I went to see it, actually. The minister took me downstairs to show me the basement where they were staying, and it was just like, I couldn't believe it, you know. So anyway, this one you might have to clap along with me. So maybe can we just start getting a little beat? I'm going to think of a bit of a timing. Let me think. Okay, lovely. So it's a song about a lady called Roseanne, someone that the soldier met, and maybe he's just kind of almost writing home, going home talking about this one. We're going to need a little bit more clap. Okay. Not faster, just more clap. Maybe just a little slower. Okay. My girl's name's Roseanne. First, oh, okay, we're that messed up, right, great. I'll start singing, and then you start clapping. That'd be easy. Okay. Okay, let's go. What the? Okay, here we go. I'm gonna start singing, and just Jenny coming in, and then we'll open it. Okay. My girl's name's Roseanne. First kissed her a man away. Took me by the hand, said I'm a handsome man. Lord, thank you for that day. Living in a town named Pontypool, where the hills are green and the rivers are cool. Worry of war makes my belly roll, but they're calling me a hero. I've been in the pubs where the men are white. Pat me on my back and say I'm alright. I've been thinking about France every night. I don't wanna go, I don't wanna fight. My girl's name's Roseanne. First kissed her a man away. Took me by the hand, said I'm a handsome man. Lord, thank you for that day. I wrote you a letter so you know that I'm safe. Don't worry about me, mother. I wish you could see the smile on my face. Wish you could meet my lover. Say that we'll be leaving in a couple of days. Our boats on the sea. If this is the last time you hear from me, just know that I've been set free. My girl's name's Roseanne. First kissed her a man away. Took me by the hand, said I'm a handsome man. Lord, thank you for that day. My girl's name's Roseanne. First kissed her a man away. She took me by the hand, said I'm a handsome man. Lord, thank you for that day. Thank you for that day. Lord, thank you for that day. Hey, hey, hey. Hey, 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 hey. It's awful daunting singing as well, you know, without any music on the cover. So thank you for joining in with the claps, that's what I really appreciate. I might actually just sing another song now. A song that you'll probably know, it's called Trouble So Hard. Moby actually sampled this, but it's a song from, Vera Hall sang this, but again, it's another African-American, it's a spiritual song. So songs that came from the times of slavery, songs that kind of, you know, led into the blues and kind of also, you know, inspired most of the music that we listen to today, or so they say. But these songs, they're strange because obviously they're sad, but there's a certain sense, there's a sense of liberation when you sing them or when you hear them. And again, actually back to Paul Robeson. Paul Robeson sang a lot of these songs, and he found again that people all over the world connected to those songs, those slave songs. People, for some reason, they felt it. He didn't really realize just how much suffering was going on all over the world, you know? And I think that's just another lovely, a special thing about that man, Paul Robeson. What an absolutely sensational human being, really. Almost like some people are just put here to just do special things, and I think that he was one of those people. So anyway, this is called, Vera Hall actually recorded this, Moby used it. And I'm going to give it a go. So perhaps you can join in with the claps after I start. I never know as well what pitch to start with when you've got nothing to kind of give a little jam and think where you're going. So if I mess up a little bit, I'll just snatch it back and we'll go again. Okay. So Trouble So Hard. Oh, actually, I don't know if you need to clap to this one because I think I might change with the tempo. I don't know. We'll just see how it goes. We'll just see how it goes. Oh Lordy, trouble so hard. Oh Lordy, trouble so hard. Don't nobody know my trouble but God. Don't nobody know my trouble but God. Went outside other day. Soul got happy and stayed all day. Oh Lordy, trouble so hard. Oh Lordy, trouble so hard. Don't nobody know my trouble but God. Don't nobody know my trouble but God. Went in the room other day. Looked on the bed and brother was dead. Oh Lordy, trouble so hard. Oh Lordy, trouble so hard. Don't nobody know my trouble but God. Don't nobody know my trouble but God. Oh Lord, trouble so hard. Oh Lord, trouble so hard. Don't nobody know my trouble but God. Don't nobody know my trouble but God. Strange thing, like I said, with those songs, they make me tingle and they make me feel just lovely. And you're singing about sad things, so it is very strange. But that's the liberation of kind of creative expression, something that comes from such a dark time, and we're still kind of singing it and thinking about it. You know, all of these years later. But yeah, if you don't really know many of those African American spirituals, it's well worth kind of giving it a listen. They're just phenomenal. And when you will hear things, you'll be like, I know where that's from. You'll hear how people was inspired. You know, take Nirvana, for example, Lead Belly. You know, mm-hmm. They love Lead Belly. They're singing, what is it? What's the song Nirvana covered of his? My Girl, My Girl, My Girl Don't Lie. And I love that song. You know, when you see the Nirvana do it on the MTV, but it's just amazing. And it isn't until you start doing more research you realise just how much they've just continued to inspire people. So yeah, and they're folk songs, they're our songs, they're all of ours. I'm going to read a poem now, a poem that's from my next collection. Well, it's not actually, I've just snuck in with my publisher another collection which is going to be out in September, so I really appreciate them doing that, because I realised Daydreams and Jellybeans was like 3 years until the next publication, and poetry's a bit more reactive, and I visit a lot of schools, hundreds of schools all up and down the UK, so I'm always writing poems, and I feel like if they haven't got somewhere to go, it's a bit of a shame, do you know what I mean? So and also then they'll say, oh, you know, don't make any videos on that poem, or don't do this, don't try to perform that too much, because obviously wait till the book launch and things like that. So it's like, no. Anyway, they're just silly poems, but I feel like they're necessary, you know, humour is very necessary. So this one is from an ant. Who's really just looked at an ant or a load of ants and thought, hang on a minute, what are you doing? Put your hands up if you've actually ever thought that. Yeah, ants are crazy. Something I used to do a bit more when I was a child. But, you know, I am a poet, I'm a freelance, I do get that time nowadays to just philosophise and things. So anyway, this is from an ant. It's very fast because, like I said, it is a poem from an ant, and it goes like this. And I mean, it is very fast. So you know, just keep your ears peeled. Ant. Busy, busy, all the time, carrying things, 10 times my size, a leaf or piece of moldy bread, an injured arm with a broken leg, sometimes I don't know where I'm going. Busy, busy is all I'm knowing, up, down, left, right, zigzag, zoo, there's always something else to do. That's it, it's fast. This is another poem from the next collection, it's called The Dragon in Question, and it goes like this. It's quite fast as well. Did you hear anything out of that poem? Yeah. Just a tiny bit. So you don't really know what happened. I'm going to read it one more time. It's only 10 seconds long. Okay, here we go. Busy, busy, all the time, carrying things, 10 times my size, a leaf or piece of moldy bread, an injured arm with a broken leg. Sometimes I don't know where I'm going. Busy, busy is all I'm knowing. Up, down, left, right, zigzag, zoo, there's always something else to do. Okay, so that's Ant. And this is called The Dragon in Question. I wrote this just for an anthology that's coming up. I was asked to write some poems about dragons. This is a poem. The Dragon in Question. Hopefully I remember it. The dragon in question is more like a mouse. He isn't a mouse, but he lives in a house. Not in the house, but under the house. The dragon that's more like a mouse. He's tiny, you see, not as small as a flea, but smaller than what you'd imagine he'd be. He's more like a mouse living under the house. He burps tiny flames from his miniature mouth. And would you believe he loves cheddar cheese? It's yummy, he says, very yummy. Before scurrying away in a mouse-like way with plenty of cheese in his tummy. And I'll never know why he never does fly, but I promise you this, I tell you no lie, the dragon in question is more like a mouse. He's more like a mouse living under the house. That one many times, so sorry about that. And it is another fast one. I got slightly stuck there, but I'm sorry about that. So, Guilty. We had Jellybean at the start, so, you know, we had this dirty, horrible, hairy, stinky Jellybean. And that's bad enough, but then there's another thing, getting caught for doing so. So this one is called Guilty, and it goes like this. Guilty. Hands in the air. Turn around slowly. Open your mouth. You look guilty to me. Apparently you ate a dirty jelly bean off the floor and it was covered in hairs. That's against the law. Stay right where you are and I wouldn't get smug. They all start this way, the full-time thugs. You're coming with me, you can't be trusted. The whole village knows and we are all disgusted. It's a bit playful, so... Anyway, The Gardener. So this is another poem from the Carew's Rich and Diverse History, or web development page thing. And this is about a man called John Estamptlin. Has anyone ever heard of John Estamptlin? Okay, so this man, well, I come from a background, you know, I come from a building background. I'm a plasterer by trade. I've always worked in the building industry, and then I started writing poems. And actually, I took myself to university, and I was studying building surveying, and I managed to get myself a job as a senior building surveyor. Really good family, all happy, you know, good job, excellent. But the problem was, I was writing poems, and I wrote a book that did all right, or well, you know, was doing okay enough. So yeah, I just quit. and they couldn't understand in Tobin, you know, like, you're quitting for poetry. What kind of poem? That Jelly Bean one. Look, I get a book in schools, but no, it's been really good. And why not? Why not? Do you know what I mean? Why not? I was lucky, you know, I go to lots of schools. And yeah, I love it. And then I think that when you are full-time, when you do take that leap sometimes in life, then more work kind of comes your way because people knew, organisations knew, which is why they obviously asked me to do this project, knowing that I write for adults, knowing that I write for children and so on. But what I'm saying is, yeah, I had a lot kind of, I've had to go a long way really from all those days on the trowel plastering thinking, and that was the joy of it, thinking all the time. When I got the jobs of building surveyor, I didn't have no time to think because I was thinking all day. I couldn't, when I would try and write when I got home, I couldn't do it. I wrote more poems when I was plastering, and people look down on these kind of, you know, certain trades or people who do things with their hands, but I was always quite a philosophical plasterer, you know. But, and lots of the plasterers and builders that I meet are very philosophical. Some of the, you know, some of the most thoughtful people that you will meet, perhaps they might not be able to say it in such ways, but they say good things, you know, and it's a good camaraderie and it's a good togetherness. To be honest, I've missed that a lot. Even when I went into builders a few years, I was on my own, you know, and I'd walk onto site and they, you know, the boy, you know, I turn up and as a manager, the worst thing to turn up as when you, and I can't believe it because I was, well, you know, always one of the lads, always having a laugh, having a sing song, and I'd hear, you know, they'd see me, and next thing you'd hear the music go down, and I'd be like, all right, boy, you know, what's happening, all right? They'd be like, just knocking that wall down here. Yeah, mate, yeah. Anything else you up to? You out on the weekend? Nah, mate, nah. And it's like, oh, the difference when you become a manager is so strange. Anyway, the reason why I wanted to start talking about that is, you know, the simple things that we do in life. And again, you see all these fancy things, you know, civil rights leaders and political leaders and musicians, rugby players, all these things on this annex. All these people that they thought perhaps you could that I could celebrate or commemorate. But when I saw The Gardener, I thought, wow, why? You know, why is there a gardener on here? That's lovely. That speaks to me. So John Estamptlin, in brief, before I read this poem, was kidnapped. He was taken from Africa at about 8 years old, I think, in the 1700s, late 1700s. He was brought to North Wales by the Wynne family. He worked on the family estate, which is now the Reig estate, actually, so they're still going. A huge landowners in North Wales. But he's something of legend in North Wales. There's a pub called the Black Boy Inn, and that's named after John Estamptlin. He is something of legend for some reason. I think that just because he was well-loved in the community, he was obviously spoke fluent Welsh, fluent English. Obviously, he had a hard time at first. He was kidnapped. At the end, he had a traumatising start. But it's what he did afterwards, you know. And I just thought he played the violin. And anything that you can find just states that he was just well-loved. He ran away with a woman called Margaret Griffith. She was the maid. She used to bring him food and things. And so they are one of the first recorded interracial marriages in Wales. So it's just, an interesting story. I thought, how is he living like this, this kind of freedom? You know, freedom, the same freedom that a lot of the people who worked on the land had, really. But this is a black person who, you know, transatlantic slavery is still going on, and I know he's got there for that reason, but he just, you know, I don't know. So this is a poem from the perspective of the gardener, John Estamptlin. Jack D, he's known as a lot in North Wales, Black Jack. The gardener. I'll take cover, watch the rain pass, the smell of water on the summer grass. This is my boundary, my place, within the old stone, cold stone walls. I am the gardener. I clear things up, make good, plant seeds, watch them grow, mist and light, moss and bark. I know where wind moves, why birds sing. My thoughts drift, wrap and climb like clematis, and nothing separates me from this land but the cries of my mother. A dream or nightmare, a mixture of both. I see the maid, Margaret, tiptoe through the meadow, her fear a few steps ahead. I'm hacking at bramble, she's butterfly quiet, but I am no black devil. Maybe she'll run again, flinging the plates of bread and ale. But if she stays, I'll show her the roses, how petals make use of shadows. Or is it the opposite? I'll turn soil for her. Show her that darkness isn't emptiness, but endless giving. Flowers are birthed here, food and life. I hope the sun pours light upon our skin, and we melt into each other, into everything. And maybe the trees will speak, as they sometimes do. Whispers from the shade, run, run away. Thank you very much. So two more songs to finish. I hope that, well, I've never sung this one. Well, actually, I've only really ever sung any of these songs to children. As I said, I mainly go around schools. Actually, none of these other songs I've sung, maybe the Jelly Bean Blues, which is the last one. But this one's Gaucho. So I was fascinated by Gaucho. I got horses, so I love that horse life. But when I found out about the Gauchos, do you know about the Gauchos? Gauchos, South American cowboys, basically. Fascinating, you know. I love everything about how they live. You know, they're on horseback, they're in the Patagonian mountains, rounding a cattle. I thought, oh, that's the life, you know. I like that. But what struck me was when I started reading more about them and I started watching, you know, anything I could on YouTube about these Gauchos, in Argentina especially, you know, they're very artistic as well. They'll sit down, you know, they might just, I know it's bad if you're vegan or something. I was vegan for a few years as well. But the fact is, you know, they've got lots of cattle, so when they need to eat, you know, they'll go on the cattle, the next, you know, it's up over the fire. And then they got the guitars, and then they're singing songs, and they're just up in the mountains, you know, like, what? They're writing poetry. You know, they're artists and things as well. So I've just loved the idea of the Gauchos. It felt, you know, feels a bit like me. I'm not that cool, but I'd love to go to Argentina or Uruguay and kind of maybe live for a month or so with the Gauchos. What else was I going to say about them? Oh, yeah, so actually, and then one of my friends, who I was doing a bit of filming with, Aled Jenkins, he's an amazing kind of videographer and things. He works all over the world. He does a lot for SOC's Welsh speaking. I started speaking to him about the Gauchos, as I do, because I'm always very kind of happy to talk about the things that I'm enjoying at any given time. And he's like, oh, the Gauchos, yeah. I stayed with the Gauchos for a few weeks. I was like, you stayed with the Gauchos for a few weeks? Did you really? He's like, yeah, of course, the Welsh speaking Gauchos. So that was even, I was like, the Welsh speaking Gauchos? And he was like, yeah, we stayed there. Patagonia, you know this Welsh speakers in Patagonia? I was like, yeah, I did know that, but I didn't know there was any Welsh Gauchos. Was like, yeah, you know, we stayed with the Gauchos, it was great, you know, we were doing this and doing that, driving all this cattle in across the Patagonia mountains. I thought, absolutely phenomenal. So yes, I started doing a bit more research about that, but they turned out to be, so the drovers who were kind of, the people who would drive cattle and sheep from West Wales, all the way to London, it would take about 3 weeks, you know, they were the men who the Argentinian government commissioned to go to Argentina and start irrigating the land. So really, some of the original Gauchos are Welsh anyway. So I thought, hang on a minute, this is cool, you know. But those drovers, they're no joke, you know, from West Wales. They would bring thousands of cattle through, and you couldn't really mess about. If they come through your land, you know, at that time, you couldn't really do anything, you know, because they were tough men, no messing about. You just had to put up with it, and then they'd move on. But that when they would go to London, they would sell all their stock and all. They would send the dogs back, because they would stay in London for a few days drinking, and the dogs would make their way back home. So I was like, all of these things, and I just love learning, you know. I never think you should just stop learning, and I'm just taken away by all this idea of Gauchos and everything else. So it's a long introduction into a random song, anyway. but I think it is about storytelling as well, and I like to just tell these stories to just hopefully just inspire just learning and just the joy of self-expression, everything, all those things. So I hope I don't forget any of these words. I've never sung this one either, but I'm hoping to get together with somebody and just get a couple of melodies to this one. So maybe you can just, the clap can come in when I, you know, like last time. Okay. Oh, Gaucho, living in the hills, what kind of night will it be? Riding on a horse, sky's deep blue, moon and the stars shine through. And it's lonely out there at the edge of the lake. You hadn't seen nobody for days. You sharpened your knife with wild in your eyes. Yeah, that's just how it feels to be free. Oh, Gaucho, living in the hills, what kind of night will it be? Riding on a horse, sky's deep blue, moon and the stars shine through. And you're loose as a bird in the summertime flight, smooth as a wandering stream. Rope wrapped round your side with wild in your eyes. Yeah, that's just how it feels to be free. Oh, Gaucho, Living in the hills, what kind of night will it be? Riding on a horse, sky's deep blue, moon and the stars shine through. Oh, Gaucho, living in the hills, what kind of night will it be? Riding on a horse, sky is deep blue, the moon and the stars shine through. Ooh, ooh, the moon and the stars shine through. Mm-hmm, the moon and the stars, the moon and the stars, the moon and the stars shine through. Gauchos, I might have a dedication to the Gauchos. Perhaps they'll let me join them. I got to finish with a song called The Jelly Bean Blues. So obviously you can probably guess this is, we ate the dirty jelly bean, we got caught for eating the dirty jelly bean, and now this is a song called The Jelly Bean Blues. I did write this over the 12 bar blues, but again, this is, we're gonna have to clap to this one for a finish, okay? But I'll get into it the same as last time. Here we go. This is The Jelly Bean Blues. This year's a story you might not believe. Said that I was strange, something's wrong with me. And they put me in jail, threw away the key. Said that it's a crime to eat a dirty jelly bean. And it's making me cry, ruin my life. Nowhere to run and there's nowhere to hide. I've got the jelly bean blues. I've got the jelly bean blues. Yeah, I've got the jelly bean blues. And I don't know what to do. Hey, feel so lonely, got so much to lose. Careful what you eat, cause this could happen to you. When it was covered in hairs, they said to my face, on top of the stairs, boy, you're such a disgrace. And I just didn't know what I did was so wrong. Now you're in jail, boy, and your sentence is long. And it's making me cry, ruin my life. Nowhere to run, and there's nowhere to hide. I've got the jelly bean blues. I've got the jelly bean blues. That's right, I've got the jelly bean blues. Yeah, I don't know what to do. Hey, feel so lonely, got so much to lose. Careful what you eat, cause this could happen to you. Oh, be careful what you eat, cause this could happen to you. Hey, be careful what you eat, cause this could happen to you. Thanks. I hope I didn't, you know, I didn't want to. I was worried before because I don't really perform to many adult audiences. But I thought, I hope they don't feel patronized by me reading children's poetry. But like I said at the start, this kind of poetry is open to everybody, I hope. I write for the curious nature and everyone. And I hope that you've enjoyed the mix-up. I just want to say absolutely amazing, Mark. You know, phenomenal, Rona. This has just been a lovely night. It's been a lovely day. I spent a few hours this morning workshopping with children as well, and they wrote some absolutely astonishing poetry as well. So, yeah, thank you very much. And thank you just to everybody, Lucy, everybody who's been involved in this this writing festival. It's been a real pleasure. Thank you for having me.